Hey, real quick before we get started, here's a little teaser pick for you guys. What do you think of that color? Do you like it? Hey guys, it's Hunter. Welcome back to another video. Not gonna lie, I'm kinda fighting a migraine right now. So if I'm a little low energy or I start not my words, just know it's because life is pain. But happy Sunday, or at least I hope it's Sunday because that means that I've stuck the upload schedule. And by the way, guys, how good have I been about uploading these last couple weeks? If you've been enjoying hanging out more, leave sacrificial offerings at the altar of the algorithm gods. Liking, subscribing, hitting the bell for notifications, all that really helps. And don't forget to join the Discord server. It's a really cool community and it's your best chance of getting your questions answered. The link is in the description. And with that, let's jump into it. Chegg asks, opinions on Gibson making guitars investment properties. All right, so Discord has already made their feelings known. But yeah, this was kind of a crazy thing, right? So Gibson's partnered up with a company called Rally Row to offer up certain prototype guitars that people can quote-unquote invest in. Right now we've got a Slash Double Neck, an Adam Jones Les Paul Custom, and a Tony Iommi Monkey, all signed. And Rally Road markets themselves as a platform for alternative asset investment. And already the alarm bells in my head started going off. Anytime something is marketed as alternative blah blah blah, alternative medicine, alternative facts, it's like, uh-oh, we might be dealing with some bullshit here. But in addition to guitars, they've got collectible sports memorabilia, comic books, classic cars, dude niches, right? So here's the quote from Mark Agnesi. Guitars of this caliber have historically always gone to individual collectors, but our goal was to find a way to make the ownership experience accessible to as many of our fans as possible. Thanks to Rally's unique platform, fans have a chance to own a piece of guitar history that would have otherwise seemed unobtainable. And you've probably heard that pitch before, because that's the pitch for a timeshare. Only in this case, ownership comes with an even bigger asterisk because the guitars are being held at the Gibson Garage in Nashville. So at first I'm like, okay, let's give this the benefit of the doubt. But like, $95,000 for an Adam Jones prototype? Who has done that valuation? I've seen them go for $15,000 on Reverb, which is already insane, but how on earth is this practically unplayed prototype valued at $80,000 more? And how often are these items reappraised? Like, how long does it take your portfolio to lose or to gain value? And for that matter, how are these guitars supposed to gain value at all when they're sitting permanently in a vault? They won't be played by the artist. Like, Adam Jones isn't gonna use this to write the next Tool album in 2043. It's not gonna be involved in any iconic Tool moments. And that's when I realized I'd been sucked in. I'd lost perspective. This has nothing to do with the guitar. This has nothing to do with any of the items on the Rally platform, really. The items are really only there to get people interested in and engaging with the platform. You're not actually buying a piece of an 89 Ferrari GTS or whatever. You're gambling. You're betting on other people's interest in that Ferrari. See, what Rally Road does is they turn what they call a blue chip asset, so cringe, into a company. Then they divvy it up where investors can buy fractional shares. So Rally Road is just a mini closed system stock market. Your investments are really just a bet that there's going to be a spike in interest around that item, just like the actual stock market. Be it from within the platform, like you see a lot of other Rally investors buying it too, or from other real world factors. Keeping with the Ferrari example, maybe it pops up in the next Fast and Furious, for example, like Vin Diesel flies to Mars in that Ferrari. I'm kidding, that's a terrible example. Vin Diesel would never be caught dead in a Ferrari. But yeah, so the initial valuation and share prices, they could literally be anything. It doesn't matter because essentially it's a closed system, but you do need some sort of artificial scarcity. Let's be real, for all intents and purposes, nobody actually owns the thing. Like, it stays in one spot, nobody's allowed to use it, nobody's allowed to take it home. So technically you could have as many owners as you want. Like, you could have an infinite number of people that buy in, but without scarcity, there's no value. And without value, the platform falls apart. And that's why you need these highly desirable physical assets, because they already have real world value, which can be translated to loosely associated virtual value on the platform. So when Vin Diesel becomes the first person to travel beyond our solar system in his Ferrari, demand builds for that artificial supply of shares in that Ferrari, and the investment value goes up. And that's it, you're betting on other people's interests. So no, it's not like NFTs, because NFTs are at least unique and yours. This is way dumber. And I think emphasizing the ownership aspect of the items is maybe a little disingenuous, but yeah, it's like a closed system private stock exchange. Investing in stocks is legal online gambling, and just like any gambling platform, you make the right bets, you definitely could make money off this, especially if you're familiar with the different dude niche markets. As long as you treat it for what it is. Like, you're not actually getting any sort of ownership stake in a $500,000 Porsche or a $100,000 guitar or whatever. This is a game. It's entertainment. And I'm just thinking, poor Agnesi, man. Like, the stuff Gibson makes him say sometimes. Play authentic, now owning a piece of guitar history. Come on, what history? What ownership? These guitars are sitting in a vault. But those are just my thoughts. Like, I'm not a fan of how Rally Road frames it as, like, you're an owner of guitar or automotive or sports history or whatever. And personally, I'll admit it, I'm fairly risk-averse when it comes to money. Like, I'm all about those long-term, safe investments, you know what I mean? So this platform is definitely not for me. I can see how it might be fun, though, if you're into gambling. But that's just me. What do you think about investing in guitars as an asset? And specifically, what do you think about the implementation between Gibson and Rally Road? Really, really interested in your thoughts. Leave them down below. Speaking of highly desirable physical assets, though, Ridge Wallet, the sponsor of today's video. How's that one? 10 out of 10 segue? So Ridge has been a fantastic sponsor of the channel, and they're redefining the wallet. Because traditional wallets are kind of terrible. The way they just grow and collect all this useless crap, not down with it. And neither was Ridge, so they decided to do things differently. Super compact design with durable plates made of aluminum, titanium, or carbon fiber. Usually I use the forged carbon because it looks real cool, but this week I've been feeling the navy aluminum. Why not? The color makes me happy. And if that's not your thing, they've got a variety of designs to match your personality. Plates are RFID blocking to thwart would-be scammers from stealing your card information, which would be bad. I've said it before, I love mine. I love being freed from carrying around all the useless crap. And if you want to see why so many people are switching over to Ridge Wallet, head on over to ridge.com/agafish and use the code agafish, because for you guys, it'll give you 10% off your order. Great wallets, and very thankful for the support in bringing you content. So yeah, check them out. Free shipping and returns, lifetime guarantee. Clicking the link supports the channel. If you see anything you like, code agafish for 10% off. And while you're doing that, let's jump into the next question. Hunter Bichelle says, have you seen the new Jerry Cantrell Wino Les Paul? Would love to see a demo. Cool name, man. And I did, and it's pretty much what I was expecting. A dope looking limited edition Les Paul custom very few of us can afford. And by the time this video comes out, the only ones you can get are from scalpers on Reverb for thousands more than the original asking price. That seems to be the natural life cycle of limited edition Gibson models these days. Looking at you, Adam Jones Silverburst. The thing about these Murphy Age models I find is I like them a lot. I love Gibsons and I love Relics guitars and I think they're really cool. I love watching videos and looking at pictures and hearing the stories about the guitars they're inspired by. Don't get hyped for them at all though, because they're just not attainable for me. Right, like whether or not they get all picked up by scalpers within an hour of the launch, it doesn't matter, because at $10,000, I'm still not getting one. Same with the Iommi model, Relict SG, very cool. No hype whatsoever. The new Lambo Countach looks sick. I love all the footage coming out. Not hyped. I am quite flattered that every time a new custom shop run gets announced, you guys ask for demos. And I'd love to, but like, have you seen the Gibsons that I buy? I buy the fixer-uppers, the broken-ass ones no one else wants. And I'd love to work with Gibson directly. It just hasn't happened. Maybe it has something to do with the harsh, but in my opinion, fair criticism I have for him. I don't know. Cynicism aside, I do hope they make an Epiphone version of the Jerry Cantrell Wino Les Paul custom. Right, like, it is a dope Les Paul. Wine red is such a great color for customs, and right now Epiphone only has Alpine White and Ebony. The Wino also has a piezo for acoustic sounds. That'd be really cool. The Epiphone Alex Lifeson has a piezo too, but it's a standard with a Floyd. So an $899 wine red Les Paul custom with a hardtail, ebony fingerboard, and a piezo? Yeah, I wouldn't mind that. And I vote for more Epiphones with piezos in general. But yeah, what do you think of the Jerry Cantrell Wino versus the Alex Jones? Adam Jones. You know what? Who wants to see an Alex Jones signature Les Paul custom? F*** it, I'm down. There's no lumber shortage. Oh my god, this comment took my last brain cell. I genuinely don't know how to respond to this because there literally is a lumber shortage though. Like, I tried to explain why the cost of guitar production is higher than it's ever been, and part of the reason is a global lumber shortage. And you can Google the reasons why, but I genuinely don't understand the thinking behind this comment. Like, you threw out something that's so false and so provably false. Like, you're allowed to think first before you just type in the comment box or like fact check or Google anything. And I'll admit this bothers me way more than it should, but it's like, just because you see a tree outside doesn't mean there's no lumber shortage. It broke me. This comment absolutely broke me. Before we get into the next box, I want to give a huge shout out to Christoph Schaefer and the rest of the amazing patrons. I don't know if you guys have noticed, but I'm actually trying to upload more consistently, bring you guys better and better content. And it's thanks to you guys. All the Patreon pledges go to Luke for mixing or to Jordan for editing. And it just means so much. And it inspires us all to make the best content possible. So if you want to support the channel as well, you can do that through Patreon, get bonus extras, link is in the cards. Or you can use my Thomann or Sweetwater affiliate links in the description. You know, if you're buying something anyways, it doesn't cost you anything extra. Anything I make basically goes right back into the channel and into the content, so it's a win-win. And yeah, I really appreciate you. Into the next question. Thoughts on the new Gibson mod series? You know, because of the name, I got very, very excited about these. I thought it was Gibson's answer to the Fender Mod Shop. It is not. It is not that whatsoever. So the Fender Mod Shop is like their semi-custom experience. There are a few standard shapes to start with as a base, then you can run through the configurator selecting from a limited set of spec options, like body material, color, neck shape. I say limited options because you can't go full custom, but there are a lot of them. The guitars are assembled in California and the prices are reasonably affordable too. Played around with the concept of a Tele with a full rosewood neck and fingerboard came to about $2,000, which is about the same price as their American Original series. Obviously, the guitars are very modular. You've got bolt-on necks, so it's relatively easy to do compared to set neck Gibsons. But still, because of the name, I got my hopes up for a semi-custom Gibson experience. Like, start with the standard model, choose your color options, have them factory mod it with locking tuners, your choice of Gibson pickups, maybe a Bigsby option even, and no, this is not that. The mod collection isn't so much a series or standardized collection. It's more like a bunch of random orphaned one-off guitars. Like standard Gibson guitars that have little factory modifications, like unique finishes, maybe a Bigsby. It's like the Reverb Store customs, except they've been given a fancier official title. And they can now sell direct from the website instead of paying the 5% seller's fee on Reverb. Some of them are pretty cool, like that Red Sparkle Firebird custom. Like Firebird customs are so awesome, and especially with a bright red sparkle. Or the 68 VOS with the Bigsby, a one in the world custom would be really cool. But you know what else would be really cool? An affordable semi-custom Gibson USA configurator. And not just because it's fun to personalize your own semi-custom builds, but also Gibson guitars are some of the best at retaining their value if you keep them stock. As soon as you modify them, they lose a lot of that value. So a lot of people, even if they don't love the pickups, even if they want locking tuners, they'll still keep the guitar stock. They're almost scared of making it their own because it ruins the value. So what if there was an option for people to build their own Les Paul standard with dirty fingers and locking tuners right out of the factory? That would be awesome for players. For Gibson, it would probably be a logistical nightmare. But yeah, I like the concept. I like the fan service of the Gibson mod collection. Like letting some fans own completely unique one-off Gibsons, that's awesome. That's a smart move. But also, please make the Red Sparkle Firebird custom in Epiphone form, I beg. And good news, more people were super mean to me in the comments this week, so now it's time to hear from yet another adoring fan. It's the high praise of the week. Are you reviewing a guitar showcasing how shitty you play? Jesus Christ, nah. He wins. That's a solid burn. Since we're near the end of the video, if you're looking for something else to watch in case you missed it since last episode, we had another unboxing video involving a mystery amp that's orange in color. Massive mystery. No one was able to guess what brand that was. Also unboxing the first Jazzmaster that I've owned. It's gorgeous and it's not a Fender. And then I've been experimenting with new content. Usually I like to prepare a little bit, analyze the guitars from a design perspective, contextualize new releases, but I was having my morning coffee and said it. Recorded an impromptu on the fly video reacting to the new guitar drops of the day, like the insane John Petrucci 8 string. But do me a favor, watch all of those. Give me that watch time, feed the algorithm gods. But nah, I kid. Especially the Petrucci one. Let me know what you think of the format. Maybe we can make it a more regular thing, or maybe reacting to more than just guitar releases, like songs or artist interviews or other YouTubers' content or whatever. But yeah, I've been trying to figure out the future of the content on this channel. So yeah, let me know your thoughts. And that'll do it for this week's episode of Ask a Fish. I'm gonna go lie down because, again, life is pain. No, but I do enjoy hanging out with you guys. Best job I've ever had. And special thanks to the awesome patrons for making all the content possible. Social media, merch, and Discord server links are in the description. As always, thank you so much for watching. You've been awesome, and I'll see you for the next video, which I think is a Wednesday Nostalgia Fish. So, see you then.